بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على عبده ورسوله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن اهتدى بهديه واستنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته We are still studying the hadiths that are in the chapter of اللباس the chapter that deals with clothes and what to wear and what not to wear from our series on عمدت الأحكام and hadith of today is hadith number 397 who would like to read it yes أخي
السلام عليكم
السلام ورحمة الله
narrated البراء I did not see anybody in a red cloak looking more handsome than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam his hair used to hang near his shoulders he had broad shoulders and was not short nor tall
this hadith the compiler of the Umdat al-Ahkam brought it to indicate something. And that is, what is the ruling on wearing red? And it's a long debated and heated discussion among scholars. Because each one has the evidence. And Islamically, as in Usul al-Fiqh, if there are two evidences that go against each other, what to do? They are all from the same source. So we have to follow one of four steps. First, if we have two evidences conflicting, the best and greatest thing to do when we have two conflicting evidences is to try to combine. Why? Because by combining them, we're applying both. Example, Allah says, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتَةُ وَالْدَّمُ It was made forbidden for you. The dead meat and the blood. This is general rule. Then we have a hadith where the Prophet says, alayhi salam, two dead animals are permitted for us and two blood. And he said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the locust and the fish, these are the two dead animals, and the liver and the spleen, these are the blood that are permitted to us. Now the ayah says it's completely prohibited. This is general. And there is an exception that the hadith stated. So this is the best level because we're applying both. And both are used and none of them is neglected. If this is not possible, then we go back to level two, which is abrogation. But this means that the earlier would be neglected as and would not be acted upon. But yet this happens. Abrogation is found in Islam. Intoxicants were halal. Later on, they were abrogated. So now it's haram. So now we know that these texts that permitted people to drink or to be intoxicated while not praying, they have been abrogated by this. If we cannot find the date, they are too conflicting. We can't say that this is general and this is specific. And we cannot know the date so that we can say that this abrogated that. We move on to the third type, which is to evaluate the two evidences. So if one is in the Quran and one is in the Hadith, we definitely take the Quran. If both are Hadith, but one in al-Bukhari and the other one is in al-Tirmidhi, we definitely take the one in al-Bukhari. If one is mutawatir and one is ahad, what is mutawatir? A hadith that a great number of people reported it. While ahad is one or two companions, for example. So we take the majority over the minority and so on. If all these three stages were unapplicable, we could not use them, then the last and fourth stage is that I abstain, meaning that I cannot say that this hadith is not true and this hadith is not true. Both are true, but I'm unable to combine and to join them together. Then this is a deficiency in my ability to combine. Definitely there will be a scholar or scholars that know better than me. But never ever neglect or throw away evidences that are authentic and correct. So, going back to our hadith, what is the ruling on wearing red? This hadith tells us that the Prophet wore a cloak or he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam something that is red. In other hadiths, the Prophet sallam prohibited wearing red. In other hadiths, the red was explained by having a cloak that is red with black linings into it. So the most authentic opinion, some said it is permissible to wear red anytime. Others said it is prohibited to wear red anytime, anything that has red. The most authentic opinion, which is the third opinion, which is the choice of Ibn al-Qayyim and a group of scholars, is that it is permissible to wear red when it's not 100% pure red. For example, this is red, yet it is not 100%. It has white coloring in it. So this makes it without any problem permissible. But if someone comes with a t-shirt that is blood red, red, nothing on it, we tell the brother that this is haram and it is not permissible for you to wear. Also, the hadith shows us that the Prophet had hair, alayhi salatu wasalam, and his hair was to the loops of his ears, which means that it's not little, but it's not so long. And scholars differ. What is best, to grow hair or to shave? It is something permissible. Me personally, I prefer to always keep my hair short because I don't have to spend hours in front of the mirror, you know, putting it up and doing this and that. I don't have hair to begin with. So, but it's usually best, especially for sportsmen who play sports. They usually don't want the sweat affecting them. It's best to do this. However, if someone is doing it as a sign of Iman and showing off that, listen, every couple of weeks I take Umrah, that's why I shave. When it is the sign of Al-Khawarij, for example, because the Prophet told us that their sign is to always have shaven hair or shaven heads, then one should be careful. Other than that, it's permissible. If you like to have shaved head, this is permissible. The Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, whoever has hair, he should honor it. How do you honor your hair? Meaning that you take care of it, you shampoo it, you clean it, you always have it tidy. Yet he also said that you should not comb your hair frequently. Why? Because this makes you more aware of how you look. And we see this in people spending half an hour after the shower applying hair conditioner, then applying hair gel, and they're doing it in a certain way. And before they leave, they also do this in the car where there is traffic lights. You see people doing this. What are you doing? So the Prophet forbade, alayhi salatu wasalam, combing the hair except every now and then, meaning not to make it as a habit. And at the same time, he said, if you have hair, honor it. Meaning don't come with your beard, one in the south and one in the north. The people who have big hair and untidy, this is sort of a trend nowadays. You find teenagers with this big hair. This is haram. You should not do this. You should honor your hair as the Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam. And this was indicated in a hadith when a man came with big hair and not tidy clothes. And the Prophet asked him, alayhi salatu wasalam, do you have money? And the man said, yes. He said, what kind of money? He said, I have camels, cows, sheep, everything. So the Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, that Allah loves it when he gives one of his servants money that shows on him. So the man went, took a shower, changed his clothes, combed his hair, came to the Prophet, and the Prophet approved of that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Moving on to the following hadith, which is hadith 398. Okay, the brother.
Narrated Al-Bara ibn Azib, Allah's Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam ordered us to do 7 things and forbade us to do 7 other things. He ordered us to visit the sick, follow the funeral, to say Yarhamukumullah to a person who sneezes, to fulfill an oath of a person who makes an oath, to avenge the oppressed, to answer the invitation when a person invites you, and to spread a salam. He forbade us to wear gold rings, to drink in silver, and to use al-mayasir, al-kasi, wearing silk, al-istabrak, and al-dibaj.
Okay, now the following hadith is also related, so we will take it as well. Hadith 399.
Narrated Abdullah ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took a ring of gold and he used to wear the stone of the ring to the inside of his hand and the people followed suit. One day, he sat at the pulpit and took it off saying, I used to wear this ring and make the stone to the inside. He took it off and threw it away saying, Wallahi, by Allah, I will never wear it. And the people threw their rings as well. In another narration, he put it in his right hand.
Okay, so these two hadiths, we find that they include a lot, and I mean a lot of information, especially the hadith of Al-Bara ibn Azib, seven things he ordered and seven things he forbade. So we will try our level best to look into these. Only the hadith of Al-Bara ibn Azib that includes 14 things, seven ordered and seven prohibited us from doing, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we will not have time to go through them all because they are irrelevant to our topic, which is dealing with clothes and what to wear and what not to wear. So the thing that matters to us is that the Prophet ﷺ forbade us from wearing gold rings and forbade us from a number of things that he ﷺ quoted. So he said that we should not wear gold rings. We should not drink in silver. We covered the drinking bit in the golden and silver utensils. And we should not use al-mayathir wal-qusi and wearing of silk, al-istabraq and al-dibaj. All of these five things mentioned, they are types of wear or clothes that you either sit on, as in al-mayathir, where it is something comfy that you sit on when you ride your car or you ride your ride camel or whatever. And also al-qusi and the wearing of silk, istabraq and dibaj, they are different types of silk and different names of silk, whether they are hard or soft, whether they are stiff or plain. All of these are totally prohibited in Islam. So we will not discuss the issue of silk again. Now this hadith of Al-Bara ibn Azib and the other hadith of Abdullah ibn Umar in regards of wearing gold rings. The Prophet ﷺ used to wear a golden ring. But then this ruling was what? Abrogated, because he took it off and he threw it and cast it away. And immediately the companions, may Allah be pleased with them, not seeing this and saying, maybe it's only for him. Maybe it is disliked, makruh, not haram. Maybe. No. Immediately, all of them took it off and they threw it, not using it or wearing it anymore. And the Prophet justified this, alayhi salatu wasalam, by saying that I used to do this. I used to have the stone to the inside of my palm, but then by Allah, I will never wear it again. So this was abrogated. Before it was halal. Now, we know that wearing gold for men is prohibited. What about wearing silver? There is nothing wrong for men to wear silver rings, because the Prophet ﷺ took a ring of silver and he died. Then the ring went to Abu Bakr, who wore it until he died. Then to Umar, who wore it until he died. Then to Uthman, who lost it. It fell in a well. So this is permissible for a man to wear. What about rings? Is it sunnah to wear a ring or not? Scholars differ. Some say it's a sunnah because the Prophet did it, alayhi salatu wasalam. Others say that the Prophet did not instruct us, did not recommend us to wear rings. And not only that, why did the Prophet wear a ring? The ring that the Prophet wore, alayhi salatu wasalam, was a seal. And he took it when the companions told him that whenever you want to correspond and write letters to the kings and to the rulers of other countries, they will not look at your letter unless it is sealed. So the Prophet took a ring and he had that engraving on it to be a seal as Muhammad Rasulullah, Muhammad the Messenger of Allah. But because the lines 1, 2, 3 for three words, he did not have Muhammad in top and the name of Allah on the bottom. So he had it the other way around. Allah, Rasul, Muhammad. Meaning that Allah Azza wa Jal always comes on top, even in such order when you're having the seal. And scholars say that this is not part of the Sunnah. It is something that the Prophet did, alayhi salatu wasalam, as a necessity, something he needed. And also everything else that comes follows the same concept. Meaning wearing the turban or covering the head for men. We spoke about this before. And we said that this has nothing to do with the Sunnah. And brothers quote, the Prophet went into Mecca, he was wearing a black turban. The Prophet, ya akhi, the Prophet ﷺ wore different types of turban. We have no problem with that. He wore turbans and he waist wrappers and he rode on a mule and he used to eat sitting on the floor and he used to eat with his hands. All of these, are they recommendable sunnah? Meaning that if you do them, Allah would reward you for that. The scholars say, the most authentic opinion is that no, this is part of the customs and traditions of the people. Ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, whenever he used to travel, he used to dismount his ride and pretend that he's urinating in a specific area and then moves on. And does not urinate, but he pretends as if he's urinating. And his companions ask him, why are you doing this? He said, because the Prophet ﷺ once urinated here. So is he rewarded for what he's doing? Are we supposed to do this whenever we come to the same spot because it's a sunnah? No, this is something that is natural. And there is a difference between the beard, for example. The Prophet ordered, then this, alayhi salam, is a sunnah, definitely. Not only that, it's mandatory. But nowhere we find that the Prophet says, whenever you come to the masjid to pray, take a handkerchief and put it on your head and tie it in a way so that you pray with your head covered, and when you go, take it off. Or put a head cap in your pocket. Or even worse, in some masjids in Turkey, you find caps there when you enter, immediately people give you. What is this? Now you have to. And after the salah, you find prayer beads, subha, hundreds, and then people just have to use it. All of these are innovations. They're not part of Islam. You have to know what Allah ordered you, what Allah will reward you for, and what is something that is custom. Now, what is left to say is, if someone does it because the Prophet did it, would he be rewarded or not? It's an issue of dispute. Meaning, if I rode a mule to work, would I be rewarded or not? This is an issue of dispute. I believe that you will not, because this is, it has nothing to do with Islam or religion. Not because the Prophet did it, that you should do it. He didn't recommend it. He didn't ask us to do it. So it becomes like sneezing in a particular place, or urinating in a particular place, or doing this or that, which the Prophet did not tell us or instruct us to do. We have one more hadith, and then we will open the floor for Q&As. Yes, Akhi.
Narrated, Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, that the Prophet ﷺ forbade wearing of silk except as much as this. And the Prophet ﷺ approximated his two fingers, index and the middle fingers, to illustrate that to us. In another narration for a book of Sahih Muslim, that the Prophet ﷺ forbade wearing of silk except if it is 2, 3, or 4 fingers wide.
Okay, this hadith, already we've discussed it and we've stated what is permissible to wear of silk, and also to those who are sick or they have the need to wear silk, the Prophet ﷺ permitted Abdurrahman ibn Auf and Zubair ibn al-Awwam to wear silk in battle. Not to show off, but because they had this itching or an illness that required them to wear something that was soft. Opening the floor for Q&As. Yes, brother, at the end.
Sheikh, is there any clear-cut hadith where it is prohibited that we should not wear red color? Hadith.
Is there any clear-cut hadith? Yes, there are. That the Prophet ﷺ forbade wearing certain types of clothes that are red. But again, we have to look at a number of different hadiths, and this is the role of a faqih, a person who studies the hadith. See, sometimes people think that you have to abide by the dalil, take the evidence. That's good, you have to. But if you're not qualified, then you have a problem. If you take the dalil without being able to understand it, and you said, no, I'll take the dalil and that is it. This is a big problem, and that is why we tell our brothers, it is wrong to encourage people only to follow the dalil without following the understanding. So no, you have to follow the Quran and Sunnah, that is all. And what about the hard work of the scholars who interpret this? No, everything is enough for us in the Quran and Sunnah. And I say, you are delusional. Without knowing what the scholars say, you cannot understand. I mean, therefore, it is extremely important not to take things lightly. And also, I know that people would attack me afterwards and say, oh, Sheikh is telling people not to follow the Quran and Sunnah. And this is stupid, with all due respect. What we're studying is the Quran and the Sunnah, but with the understanding of the favorite generations, the generation of the Prophet ﷺ, was Sahaba, and the Tabi'een, and those who followed them. Not with me interpreting what I like, and I think, oh, this is Quran and Sunnah. No, you have to go through proper channels and study it through the scholars of the deen, not blindly following anyone, but if you're not qualified, you have to follow someone.